not like solid thoughts in 3D and applications. Thank you.
So in my first lecture, general lecture, I discussed already the problem of excitations of Young-Mills theory in four-dimensional space-time. And well, in perturbative paradigm, we would to have for SU2 case, three massless vector fields. And of course, there are no particles in the nature which correspond to this. Nevertheless, everybody believes that Young-Mills field is good for strong interactions. And of course, we have heard a lot today about lattice work, which is very supportive. On the other hand, of course, it would be nice to find some indications of what are excitations in field theoretical terms, in true quantum field theory. And one of the possible ideas would be to have some solitons. But of course, classically, Young-Mills have no solitons because of scale invariance, because of no massive parameter. There are instantons, but that's another story. I'm speaking about particles, so it must be solitons. Static or periodic solutions of finite energy. So they don't exist classically. And on the other hand, I also said it, that quantum theory is different. And you could imagine some situation that you are, in fact, in functional integral, it's necessary to integrate not around the solution of classical equation, but around solution of quantum equation of motion, which takes into account self-action of particle or field on itself. And so, one believes that maybe this quantum equation of motion is not too much different from classical. On the other hand, some massive parameter will appear there. And so, what I was trying to do was to understand how we are to modify a little bit classical equation of motion to have solitons. But now, what type of solitons? It's three dimensional space. And solitons of 70s were in one-dimensional space. In three-dimensional space, there are several examples. One of them is Skirm model. Another is Polyakov-Toft monopole. And also in the same time, I was also struggling with this problem. And because phenomenology was different, there was no neutral currents. I was trying to introduce some field which should show us neutral direction in the three-dimensional space for charges when I united in one multiplet two neutrinos, electron, and meson, mu meson. So neutrino direction must to be shown by some field. So I use this field, N of X, which is three-component field, sum over n squared I squared equal to 1. So it's filled with values on two-dimensional sphere. And of course, the idea was that this soliton will not be point-like, but will be rather concentrated along the loop. Now, we know that in QCD, another hypothesis is that quarks are confined by means of gluonic strings. And so one can ask a question, what happens if there are no quarks? Do these strings disappear or whatever? So the reasonable answer is that they become closed. Closed string, of course, is not very stable. if its energy is proportional to length, so it will be collapsed. So there must be some mechanism which stops this collapsing. And that's, in my model, I exactly have solitons which are concentrated along the strings and which are not collapsing. So I will describe you the model and then speak a little bit how I think that it could appear in the Young Mills. When we have such field and introduce boundary condition that at infinity it's somehow fixed, for instance, looking in the North Pole, this is three-dimensional x, of course, no? Or three. Then in mathematics, with such field, one associate map from R3 with added point at infinity, which becomes S3, it's a three-dimensional sphere, into two-dimensional sphere. This is our target, and this is our space. So because of difference of dimensions here and here, each point on the target corresponds to the contour on the space. Simple contour will be just like a circle. But then one can so next point must be also a circle, must correspond also to a circle. And you can imagine that these circles are intersecting, well, overlapping something. I draw very badly, but you know, one is somehow have a linking number with another one. This situation is described in topology when people speak about so-called Hopf map. Hopf map is exactly map from S3 to S2, and it is characterized by integer number, which is called Hopf number, and this integer number is exactly corresponds to this overlapping, how many times one preimage of one point wraps around preimage of another point. So if I have now, if I consider the preimage of parallel in my sphere here, it will be kind of toroidal. You understand that's torus. And where I have my lines, and these lines will go around each other every time. So you can say if you take the cable of these lines and then twist it once, for instance, or several times, twist it and glue afterwards. Then you have a situation which is much more stable because if, of course, it has tendency to shrink, but if there is also resistance to twisting, then you will get somehow equilibrium somewhere there. So that was the kind of idea. And this idea is to be realized in terms of Hamiltonian, which somehow must take into account this possible twisting. The geometry here allows us to introduce several objects. First of all, so there's this N. But then, of course, when I have here form of the volume of the sphere, so sine theta, d phi in spherical coordinates, the forms move in opposite direction to the map. So map is here, and forms go here. So this form give me preimage also to form on my space, which can be written as follows: hik dxa dxk, where hik is din vector dkn. So gradients of n, because of this normalization condition are orthogonal to N. So I have here two vectors orthogonal to N. Their vector product is parallel to N, and so I project it on N. So as that form was exact, this form is also exact. So if I write, for instance, introduce B I, which is 1/2 epsilon I chi j h chi j, then this dual one form is has divergence zero. So B can be considered as a magnetic field. Well, you see here we have another way of parameterizing magnetic field, not via vector potential, but via this field N. And it also works. So in N we have 2 degrees of freedom, in magnetic field we have 2 degrees of freedom, so that's exactly like we want. So one can write now two possible Lagrangians. One of them is that of nonlinear sigma model, dIn squared. But then one can also have Maxwell term, B, well, let's say AHK squared. And if I put coefficients here, integral over the dx, this is my Hamiltonian. Well, it looks, so you see, it's from one point of view, it looks strangely because it contains not only second derivative, not only squares of derivative, but also fourth order derivatives, or first derivatives. On the other hand, just because of that, we don't have here Dirac abstraction for solitons, because after, when if you make scaling x to lambda x, then first term will scale in one direction. So if it's h1 plus h2, so h1 will scale to lambda h1, and h2 will scale to 1 over lambda h2, h2. And so you can think that you cannot extinguish the possible localized solutions just saying that scaling may blow them up, because you want energy to be finite, so it's one term is increasing, another term is decreasing. And then, so my hypothesis was that indeed there are localized solutions, but which are concentrated around the concentrated around the line, or around the link, or around the knot, and so on. I made this hypothesis in the middle of 70s. I lectured about that in Princeton, but at that time I was not able to check it, because in contradistinction with Skirm, where there is point-like solution, and you can reduce simplest solution to ordinary differential equations, here the most symmetric solution is axially symmetric, and so you can, oh, it must be, it's two-dimensional nonlinear differential equations, and at that time there were no tools to calculate it. So it was kind of forgotten. Well, at that time, there appeared also, because I advertised it at home, and we had very strong laboratory of Ladyzhinskaya, two young people at that group looked at it more seriously, and they proved very important a priori estimate. They proved that, oh, excuse me, I did not say important thing, yeah. Well, of course, what is this linking? I did not give you important information. This linking can be calculated through some topological current. And zero component of the topological current is nothing but Chern-Simons for this magnetic field. So you can write that this AHK is DICK minus DKCI, and consider integral epsilon IKJ HIK times CJ D3X, normalize it somehow, maybe 4 pi, I'm not sure. But then you are getting number, which for all smooth mapping is an integer. It's Einstein's dream to have current which give you charges which are quantized somehow. One of the Einstein dreams, yeah. And this number is called Hopf invariant. It's characterizes as Hopf map, and so it's here. So what these people have shown, it's their names is Kapitansky and Vukulenko. They have shown that energy is estimated from below by some constant times Q modulo 3/4. Not somehow this strange power appeared, but it's somehow connected with the fact that we have here 3 and 2 and so on. And this shows that in the sector when Hopf is non-trivial, energy is also not zero. So the vacuum solution is not living there. So you are to minimize your energy in the sector with non-trivial Q, and if you are lucky, you will get limit, which will become somehow this localized solution. This theorem is not proved yet. And so what happened is that 20 years after I proposed my model, my colleague in Finland, Antti Niemi, told me, why don't we try to show that the solutions exist numerically? He learned computer. We were given best computer in Helsinki, which was supercomputer, was not busy at all. They were calculating something, but somehow just free, gave us free time. And Niemi made enormous job and have shown that indeed in the sector of Q equal 1, there's a minimum, which is exactly this toroidal solution. Then people began to look at it seriously, more serious professionals enter. Two groups, one is also Finnish guy, Hita Rinta, and another is British, Sutcliffe and Batty. They begin to calculate more professionally, and they have shown very rich picture of excitations. So for Q equal 1, 2, and 3, they are toroidal, but only 1 and 2 are axial symmetric. 3 is already wrapped somehow. And then at Q equal 4, you get link, and at Q equals 7, you get trefoil. In the middle of 70s, in my lab, I put on the wall picture of trefoil by Escher. Escher liked this form very much, and so there are he had a lot of trefoils, and so one of them was on my wall. And this, so I was sure that trefoil will appear, and then it indeed appeared numerically. Hitarinta have very good computer movies, which shows how one iterates going to and get finally the attractor, which is this knot. All right, so mathematically, we now establish that this knot exists. Not by theorem, but by numerical calculation. And now the next thing was where to use it. So where this structure appears, both the nonlinear sigma and this magnetic. By the way, of course, British people prefer to say that it's Skirm Faddeev model, because in Skirm you had also a term which was quadratic in fourth order in derivatives, but this Skirm term is really artificial. It has no natural geometric explanation. Here I have this really pre-image of the volume, very geometric thing, magnetic field, and also Skirm solitons are point-like or crystals, and soliton of this model are not like. All right, so one application appeared also in our discussion in Finland, where we had some person from solid state theory, Yegor Babaev, and the outcome is as follows. This structure naturally appears in the Landau-Ginzburg equation when you have not one psi, not one component field, but two component field. So consider just two complex valued functions. Consider magnetic field given by vector potential. And then construct, and then, of course, then you have covariant derivative. I will not write electric charge, will not write masses, but just to have only important things. Yeah. This, of course, we have the gauge invariance when psi goes to e to I theta, well, lambda psi, and A goes to AK plus DK lambda. Then things are to be covariant derivative transforms as psi itself, everything must be covariant, and so the terms in Lagrangians are delta k psi squared plus fik squared, where f is field strength. Well, by the way, I was to say a little bit more about geometry. So if H is magnetic field, then these lines, pre-images of the point, are exactly Faraday's lines of force. They are exactly, so my knot is kind of cable of Faraday lines twisted and then closed. Well, of course, there is some potential which I shall not write here. So here it's written for one psi. Then we know that one can easily come to gauge invariant variables if one introduces psi, which is as put it as rho e to I phi, and A equal to B plus 1 over rho squared J, where J is current. This combination is called AK minus this is called supercurrent in solid state. Then, and J is usual current, you know, well, still, J is 1 over 2i psi bar dk psi minus dk psi bar psi. Then then this combination will turn into d rho squared plus rho squared b squared plus db dib minus dkb squared plus potential. And these are now gauge invariant objects. You know that current transforms like F like A. So combination B is gauge invariant. Rho is, of course, also gauge invariant, only phi is shifted. So it's kind of change to exact change to gauge invariant variables. And then we see that it looks like now usual real scalar field, but albeit it's positive from time to time, we have to remember about it. Then there is kind of vector field, but this field has also term rho squared b squared. And if rho, for some reasons, have non-trivial expectation value or whatever, potential will give this or something like that, then field become massive. What I have shown here, it's called Meissner effect, that indeed the complex gauge invariant and Landau-Ginzburg equation leads to appearance of mass in superconductor, and this is Meissner effect. So that's all just from textbooks. But what if we have tube size? We also want to come to gauge invariant combinations, but now, of course, we can introduce rho squared, which is psi 1 squared plus psi 2 squared. But there's only one phase, gauge taking phase, and here we still have three of them. So, what will be the gauge invariant combination out of psi 1 and psi 2? It will be exactly this particular case of Hopf invariance. If I introduce n, which is equal to, let's take this Pinor psi 2 square, then here tau matrices, and takes psi 1, psi 2. So quadratic form of tau matrices, and well, divided by rho squared. Then I will get unit vector. This is, so you can say that as you divide it by rho squared, you can say that psi 1 and psi 2 define you three sphere, and n defines two sphere. It's particular Hopf map. But I will use it for different reasons. And then when you substitute all this into Lagrangian, into Hamiltonian, excuse me, then you will be getting d rho squared. Then there will be rho squared dn squared. Then there will be rho squared b squared, where b is defined in the same way as here, but now current is sum of both combinations here. But then instead of that term, you will get the you will get additional term, which is this hik squared. So that magnetic field will be shifted. Only this will be massive, but then this is here. So if, once more, rho has some expectation value, then you can say that you have contribution of a massive vector field. Well, if we take into account Meissner effect, it can be neglected in a bulk, maybe. And then you have exactly my model, rho squared dn squared plus hik squared. So the prediction is that in the two-component superconductor or in two-component Bose-Gas system, there must be these excitations which are three-dimensional and closed. Well, so we are waiting for experiments, they say, that will be done sometime, but what I want to say is that these are not Abrikosov currents. Abrikosov vertex was really two-dimensional, and it is connected with the map from S1 to S1, namely that just only phase of one field psi is involved there. So here we need two psi's, and then you get this prediction. Okay, so that's half time. And now let's go to Young Mills. I will not be able to give all detail, it's rather long, but I will give some ideas how these degrees of freedom could appear in the Young Mills. There is a very long article in Nuclear Physics by Niemi and me, and if some young people will be interested, they can find reference. There we have a very long and detailed article about this. So I will discuss today SU2 case. There is a paper also with how things are generalized to SU3, there are SU2 is special because it's rank one, and let me see. And the dimension of Cartan's subalgebra is one, are the same. In SU3, they're different, so there is a little bit more complication. You understand, of course, that, well, okay. You will see that rank and all this will be used. So it's pure Young Mills, no quarks. So the degrees of freedom are vector field. Now I will write four-dimensionally. A mu A, there is a gauge transformation, A, well, if I write A mu A, A mu equals A mu A tau A as a matrix, then there is gauge transformation, A mu goes to G. Now, in every paper I use different regular, different, so G A mu G minus 1, plus d mu g minus 1. And Lagrangian is just written in terms of curvature. I don't introduce charge, just like that. Now I will partly fix the gauge. I will speak about so-called maximal abelian gauge, when I distinguish between the charge components and A3. And A3 I will treat like electromagnetic field. So I have covariant derivative, just abelian covariant derivative, and maximal abelian gauge is condition that nabla mu b mu equals zero. It's still invariant with respect to abelian gauge transformation. So, B mu going to B mu F x lambda and A mu going to A mu plus D mu lambda.
Question, please?
Yes?
In that Lagrangian, the four derivative term becomes comparable in importance to the two derivative term when distances, when derivatives are of order rho, right? If you compare the four derivative and the two derivative term has rho squared, mm-hmm. Like it. So the four derivative term becomes important only when derivatives are of order rho.
Yeah.
At those distance scales, even the massive gauge field is an important excitation.
Well, unfortunately, you are, in your suspicion, you are right. Until now, I was not able to prove that there is a minimum, non-trivial minimum in this Lagrangian. And so people, so now it's a problem of numerics, so to say. So for short time, for what potential, and somehow we can, this makes kind of quasi-stationary situation of the sort. But minimum, Dirac theorem is, now is not circumvented. That's true.
Right, but there's no limit in which you can ignore B. There's no limit in which the four-derivative term is important and B can be really ignored.
Well, I believe you're right, yeah. So, that's usual things. And now, if I use L mag to be equal to L Young Mills, where L is usual Lagrangian, and adding this type of Gupta term, delta mu by mu modulus squared, then altogether it will be written in terms of the charge vector field. So nu is just something like index of the charge field plus 1/2 F mu nu plus G mu nu. I will say what is, and plus 1/2 G mu nu F mu nu. So this comes from the contribution of three field strength. This comes from A1 and A2, and this comes from A2, where, of course, we remember that F mu nu is now abelian. And G mu nu is equal to 1 over 2i B mu B nu minus B nu bar B mu, so some anti-symmetric tensor. So that's that non-linear term which enters into third component of curvature out of the A1 and A2. There's this strange term also because, well, you know, when in abelian case, when you have Gupta blur, it's really, you integrate by parts, everything disappears. But now it's not disappearing, so this remains, this term remains. So one must be more careful in canceling, in integrating by parts and canceling these terms. Well, that's just rewriting the same Lagrangian, and what can we do? I want to get something like psi for previous example. How to get it? I now say that the two vectors, this or complex vector B or two vectors A1 and A2, give me plane in my four-dimensional space. So I will introduce Zweibein, which defines this plane, and then write them as a decomposition into Zweibein. This means that I introduce field E mu, which is E mu 1 plus I E mu 2, which is normalized. E mu bar E mu equal 1 and E mu squared and E mu bar squared equals 0. Cured. And in right B mu as we decompose with respect to this basis. Write B mu as psi 1 E mu plus psi 2 E mu bar. Where psi 1 and psi 2 are two complex coefficients. Well, of course, here we have five real components. In psi we have four real components. But B mu have eight real components. But what is clear now that I can also have, I have gauge freedom somehow. I can change E mu into E to the omega I omega E mu and change psi 1 into E to the minus E omega psi 1 and psi 2 into E to the omega psi 2. So there's a new gauge freedom which kills one of these degrees of freedom out of 9, give me only 8. Well, with this new gauge degree of freedom, I must also associate connection. And this connection is written in terms of A mu. So I call it gamma mu, which is equal to 1 over I. E mu E nu bar d mu E mu. That's usual stuff when you have orthonormal system of vectors, then you can get this connection. So this, after this transformation, of course, this transforms as gamma mu to gamma mu plus d mu omega, small omega. Well, from geometrical point of view, this is kind of Grassmannian variable. It gives us somehow parameterization of planes embedded in four-dimensional space. And so it's Grassmannian gamma, well, G to 4. And essentially, this is nothing but product of two spheres, two-dimensional spheres. And one can realize this explicitly by introducing just a moment by writing that H, not H, it was G mu, yeah? G as rho squared. If I now use the same transformation of psi, so rho and n, then it will rho squared, n3 squared, where n is the n3 from that, times small g mu, and then if I say that pi is g null I, and as usual in Maxwell, and qi are 1 half epsilon I chi j g chi j, then I will get that p squared plus q squared equal to 1. And p and q are orthogonal. And out of this, I can construct two spheres. Well, so you see that I found the place in Young-Mills to introduce this field N. But besides, I also have another unit sphere which appears here. In fact, if I can now come to statics, then zero, as usually, zero components are zero, and so I will get field Q, which is also unit, have values on the unit sphere. kind of duality, electromagnetic duality. So I have now not one field, but not one field with the unit sphere, but two. And now what we have done, well, we just substituted all this change of variables into Lagrangian. Takes some time. And what I will do, I will write you down the answer. I shall write the answer in the case of static case, so the time derivatives disappear, and as I say, only vector q appears. It's rather long expression. I call it E just for all this energy density. So it will be dk rho squared plus rho squared, and then delta k gamma. That's covariant derivative with respect to connection gamma of n squared plus usual dk q squared. So kinetic energies for n and q, then rho squared. What is C? C is, well, C must be defined later. Ck squared plus and your chalk is plus 1/4. Well, dkn, vector dk, dIn, dkn times n squared, n, one of this magnetic field, then the same for q, diq, dkq times q, then two, GIK, and then plus DICK minus DKCI. All this is squared. And there is also an additional term, minus 3/4 for some reasons, rho to the fourth and 3 squared, kind of Higgs. And Ck is supercurrent. So C is Ak plus 1 over rho squared. But of course, supercurrent now is written in terms of the covariant derivatives. So not only dk, but plus IAK plus I gamma K psi, and the same with psi 2, where one of the signs is different. I will not write down. And minus, of course, complex conjugate. Well, long expression, nothing doing, but we see that this structure, once more, structure which was characteristic to my model, somehow exists here. And to.
This is the standard Yang-Mills Hamiltonian.
That's just standard Yang-Mills. It's exact, it's no changes, only in the. The only thing is this maximal abelian gauge. But of course, to. To begin to do some serious things with this, one must once more realize why rho squared is not zero. And when I was lecturing about this several years ago in Munich, Zakharov Valentin Zakharov stand up and say, but you want the condensate of dimension minus 2. I say, unfortunately so. But he said, no, it's not unfortunately. I also want it. And indeed, there is quite a lot of literature about possibility of the expectation value for b squared. So that b1 squared plus b2 squared. The condensate, not f mu squared, not condensate of dimension 4, but condensate of dimension 2. Of course, it's very not gauge invariant, but it's somehow very much connected with abelian, with mag, with this maximal abelian gauge. Because if you consider the functional b mu squared and then make it gauge transformation on it, and begin to minimize over gauge, then you will get maximal abelian gauge condition. So in a way, this condensate is that of b mu squared only in the gauge, in the maximal abelian gauge. And in other gauges, you have to recalculate it so to get something that will appear to gauging it back. So it's not that completely impossible. But in fact, still, such existence of such condensate must be argued either mathematically or on the lattice or whatever. And as I say, people discuss it a lot now, independently of our proposal. But in our proposal, it's crucial for having maybe excitations which are these knots, or maybe magnetic monopoles and so on, because N-field also produce nice magnetic monopoles. And well, so this is new variables for young Mills. I will never put these variables into functional integral. I think that functional integral must be done in usual variables, but then one it will be must be substituted into effective action, which you get by the ground field method, and then treated classically in this sense. And so the classical solutions of this effective energy must correspond to some quantum solitons. But, well, I had enough force to make this ansatz, but to work with this further is too complicated for me. And I will finish with a comment, which is also in that paper with Niemi, is that this Lagrangian, exact form of Lagrangian, can be reinterpreted in the way when field rho will appear as a dilaton. You can introduce metric g mu, which is rho squared, eta mu, where eta mu is flat metric. Then this term, g rho squared, will be curvature. This will be something like the lambda, how you call it. This constant in cosmological constant. And everything will be covariant with respect to this this conformal metric. So appearance of conformal metric in young Mills, I think, is quite interesting phenomenon. What is that? And in fact, later, we have used it with Niemi in a completely different setting, namely in setting of the Weinberg-Salam model, where we also introduced gauge invariant variables, and there appeared some variable rho instead of Higgs, which could be treated as dilaton, as a really factor, conformal factor in the metric. The, I have a short article on that, which is called Alternative Formulation of the Weinberg-Salam Model, and so I can only advertise it. But on this, I will stop. Thank you.
Is that condensate related to the same B square
condensate
here?
That is
a monocore.
But whom you have in mind?
For example, the Russian group Polyakov and so on. Those people have done such
stuff. Polyakov.
Polyakov.
Well, we discussed with him. Yes, of course. Yeah. No, we speak with him from time to time. Several people have taken it more seriously, so there are several papers by Kondo, who is using our approach, and I have seen even some Japanese paper where there was lattice approximation, some lattice reformulation of the change of variables. But until now, it is rather complicated, so I don't know.
And alternatively, if we don't do the gauge fixing, such an interpretation is just not possible?
Well, I told you this connection of that condensate is kind of gauge invariant in maximal gauge, in maximal abelian gauge. So they're intrinsically connected, maximal abelian gauge and the condensate of dimension 2.
But in the overall SU2, it is not gauge invariant?
Mm-hmm. No, of course not. Yeah.
It's in a fixed gauge, actually. In that sense, it is gauge invariant.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But in maximal abelian gauge, we still have this abelian part. And this abelian, for that, everything is completely gauge invariant.
Residual gauge dependent freedoms.
Yeah, but the, because with respect to that, everything is gauge invariant. Well, this idea of making, instead of gauge fixing, coming to gauge invariant variables, of course, maybe not very good, but nevertheless, it works from time to time, yeah.
So your main point is that if somehow there is a gluon condensate, actually,
yeah,
in the vacuum,
mm-hmm,
you will give...
Yeah. no.
So there's a dimensional object, actually, that...
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Then this Hamiltonian can support the type of soliton solution.
Well, maybe not completely not completely stable, but somehow semi-stable. Yeah.
Stable, right?
No, it's still there's no estimate from below. That only for the model. I had it. This estimate I had only from a model, as already was remarked. Even in this Landau-Ginzburg, such stability is still not clear. So it will be more numerical rather than mathematical.
But the difference between the abelian case you showed and this one is that this is a rewriting of the same Hamiltonian.
Yeah.
Without any higher order terms.
Yeah.
The previous example had higher order terms, four derivative terms. There's a difference actually between
No. In both cases, in both examples, it's only rewriting Hamiltonian.
But the previous Hamiltonian
because,
has
but,
square terms.
But in the change of variables, I use also change which involve derivatives, and so that's how. So you say field plus derivative of another field. So then quadratic in first field will give you four derivative in second field. No, it's all exact change of variables, no problem.
In some sense, actually, the choice of maximal abelian gauge is to come to the first problem.
Yeah.
Which was abelian and showed that kind of thing. Now, of course, we have two of them.
Thank Professor Faddeev for this set of four lectures which cylindrical